panel. And welcome to the Adventure Time panel. Yay! I just want to say thank you to the Toronto Public Library, the Beginning, the presenters of the Toronto Comics Arts Festival, TCAF, and thanks to Seneca College, our program sponsor. I'm going to ask if everyone could like turn off sound making devices, like your phone,
boom boxes,
your pagers. Thank you. Now we're going to start with our lovely guests.
We should all introduce ourselves.
Yeah, we should. I think we've got two moderators as well.
Are you moderating with me?
Sure.
Okay, cool.
I'm the whole moderator.
Yeah. All right.
Hi, I'm Frank Gibson. I am a writer of comics. I am not involved in like Adventure Time pretty much at all, so I've just been asked to kind of like come along and like keep things rolling around. My partner Becky, we just had an Adventure Time comic come out called Baby Cakes. It's the Adventure Time annual 2014. But yeah, we do other stuff, we do other comics, but this is not about us, it's about Adventure Time. And so yeah, we have a bunch of really rad people on the panel today. We have Kate Leth, who is writing, you're writing like everything these days, right?
That is the fact, yes.
Yeah.
I wrote two books for Adventure Time. I wrote the first one that's out now called Seeing Red, it's about Marcy and Jake. There's a second one that's coming out in the fall that no one knows what it's about yet, except the 400 people I told at my table today when I was supposed to. And I'm taking over as series writer for Brave's Warriors, starting with issue 21.
And then we also have Jesse, who works on the actual show too, so that's cool. Jesse, can you tell me like a little bit about your work? Because you also do comics in addition to Adventure Time.
I do a comic through NoBro called Forming. The second book came out this weekend, sort of, but it got...
can you tell the story about what happened to the book?
The customs, because it's called Forming Volume 2, so the customs thought it was shampoo, and they called it they thought the paperwork was wrong for it, and they were like, this is shampoo, this isn't books, and they didn't bother to like, get a box or whatever, so my publisher had to bring a backpack of like 16 books to the show, so I don't know, I guess I'll have a better gig.
Oh, yeah.
So, in this show, but yeah, I storyboard and write on the Adventure Time.
Is there a shampoo called Forming Volume?
I don't know, because you like, you know, full of hair.
That's great.
Yeah, like, I kind of figured it'd just be like some guy opens up the box and he sees like Forming Volume 2 like written on the book. And he just like opens it up and just like puts it on his head. Like, oh yeah, cool. Yeah, this is all wrong. Oh, we also have Michael DeForge with us, who works remotely on the Adventure Time, right?
Yeah, I'm the props and effects designer.
And you also do comics too, right?
Yeah, I have a comic debuting this weekend called A Body Beneath, and it collects issues of a series I draw called Lose. And this year I also did, that's Koyama Press, and I also did a comic with Drawn in Quarterly this year called Ant Colony.
Cool.
And Michael also storyboarded the episode Little Dude.
Yeah.
I did that.
it was you who did it.
Yeah, with Cole Sanchez.
Cole's awesome.
Yeah.
Why doesn't Cole ever come to these things?
Right.
I don't know.
Yeah.
You guys can like move the mics. So
no, I just want to lean like this all the time.
But yeah, it's cool. You can move the mics. It's better.
Does that make me look cool if I just like lean forward constantly?
Like you would hope. It's okay to move them closer. So, you know.
Cool. And then we also have Ryan North, Toronto's own son, Ryan North, right? with your Canada shirt.
Yeah, representing. I was born in Ottawa, but
yeah.
Oh,
but I moved here 10 years ago, and I like it.
Cool. And you write the Adventure Time comics.
Yes.
And you also do the dinosaur comics.
Yes.
And the Hamlet book.
Yes.
And yeah, this is my partner Becky. She does like a lot of like covers work for the comic and also drew Baby Cakes. So, yeah. Talk about your work.
Oh, I mostly draw cats. Yeah, I just do like freelance, and we do a comic called Tiny Kitten Tape and a kids book called Tiger Bunny.
Oh yeah, and Becky is also lead character designer on Being Puppy Cat.
Yeah.
And I co-wrote it, it's no big deal.
How do we want to start this off? Because like at some point we meant to do like drawing of like art, and then also like we should probably get like questions from you guys, because it like there's no notes on any of these.
Break it down. Rules. So this is how the drawing is going to work. We're going to split up into teams, and Frank is going to come up with some words that, like Pictionary, but it's legally distinct from Pictionary. And the trick will be, he'll need to communicate that word to you in the audience without the person drawing or the people trying to guess knowing what that word is. Mm-hmm. So what I propose is the classic fingers in the air, move them around, and make noises. So you can't hear, because if you cheat, we'll all know, because you'll guess it right away.
Or you can like write it down.
Like write it down.
That's even better.
And then I can like show it individually to each member of the audience on small piece of paper.
Yeah, well.
Oh no, I'll just say it really loudly, I'll write it down, but I'll say it if it works right.
Is this legible?
Yes.
Perfect.
Tight.
So three letter words will work.
Alright,
So yeah, let's just, do we have to have teams, or can we just, like, go individually or something?
We can do individually.
Yeah, like, as someone who was in America for even sold, like, individual thing.
How's that working out?
Alright,
Do you want me to go first, since I just explained the rules? And I can't draw, like, I write the comics, I do not draw the comics. So this will be a good first test round with someone who doesn't draw, but no shapes. Like I do shapes and colors.
Okay. And so like, so for the art, so while you're drawing it, are they helping you out in some kind of way?
No.
Or are they just laughing at you?
Have you played?
I have no idea what a Pictionary is.
So the way the game works is that, let's say it's dog, and let's say everyone on the panel is guessing.
Cool.
The audience knows dog. You know dog. I know dog. Everyone else doesn't know dog. The panelists don't know dog.
Okay.
So I'm trying to draw a dog, and they have to guess and say dog, but my drawing might look like a cloud, and they'll be like, cloud, canine, and they don't win until they say something close to or exactly dog.
Okay, we should start with dog.
But we all know it, so think of a noun that can be drawn.
Okay.
And then I'll go try to draw it, and we'll have some fun.
Okay.
All right.
And that's the end of the panel.
Okay.
You
guys need to see it. Okay.
Okay, sorry.
Becky's disqualified. I can put it behind them. It's so tantalizingly close they can almost know what it is. Y'all got that? Cool. All right.
Can we all see this?
Is it hidden? Is the board hidden now?
Can you look at the board now?
Can you see it?
Can you see the board?
You hit the board.
Yeah, the board's hidden. The board's gone, man.
Okay.
Yeah.
And if you hit the podium backwards, then you'll be able to see better.
Oh, I'll try. I'm weak. I'll try.
We can do it as a team. Watch out for that guy. Yeah, look at this. This can go everywhere.
Wait,
what if the audience?
For me. You put it right
here. Yeah.
The only thing he's done this before.
Better?
No.
Everyone?
Yeah, sounds great.
Maybe, yeah, there's some secret one.
Yeah, let's go. All
right.
Yeah, I got it.
So everyone knows a word? All right, you guys ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Give me a ding or something.
Okay, like.
No, you got a ding.
Oh, yeah, cool.
All right. Yeah, there we
go. Do you need a reference?
Basically.
More abstract, I think.
Yeah.
No, like a concept, you know, something I can't even draw.
Yeah. Great.
Oh, yeah.
Do it. Make it happen.
Okay. I'm doing the word for you.
Cool.
That's too easy.
You got this, man.
All right. It's my fly down. All right.
Does anyone want that cool picture of a bike?
14 cents.
So,
should we pull that one off or should we just?
Oh, yeah, we're
going to. Oh, okay, cool. Yeah. So, someone gets two drawings. Okay, I got it. Yeah.
It's a word game.
We'll tie it into the show. Yeah. Yeah, adventure guy.
What?
French fries?
Fries.
Froyla.
What? Darker color.
A horse? Horse name.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
Do it.
Prince?
Yeah.
I'll draw.
So someone else has to come up with a word, or?
Yeah,
Mike comes up with a word.
Or Becky.
Yeah, Mike comes up with a word.
Yeah.
Okay, and then I have to try and draw you. Okay. I understand the rules. I got one here. We have the lid, so.
Yeah, you can have a lid.
Okay.
That's a really good drawing, Prince.
Is this a drawing? Happy camera. Yeah.
Oh, no, that'd be fun. That'd be fun. Can people see that? The first time?
Oh, yeah. Look, everybody, except the people at the time. Is that visible?
Sorry.
I'll make it enormous.
I don't know if I
can
make it Adventure Time
themed.
I'm
going to
try. I'll throw a Jake in there.
Oh.
Can we look?
No. Are we safe?
Great.
Okay. Can I start?
Yep.
Okay.
Dang.
I'm also not a very good artist. I write. Okay. Let's see if we can do this.
Jake.
Marceline. Princess Bubblegum. Wait, happy Princess Bubblegum. With different hair and no crown. That's a word. It must be words.
Oh. That's it.
Mystery. Censored comics. creepy guy. What does his hat say? Sausage?
No, save it.
That's his words.
Eve?
No, save it.
Oh. Okay, is that me? Okay, what's going on here?
Look. We'll get there.
This is Adventure Time, Pete?
No.
He has?
Yes!
Okay, so do you guys want to do a Q&A or something?
Let's do some questions. Let's talk Adventure Time.
Alright, so let's say as people form, do we want to do hands up, or do we want to have a line?
Probably
hands up? Alright, cool. He put his hand down. Okay, guy with hand up actually gets to do it.
Alright, sweet. So I guess I'll stand. I'm going to preface this with spoilers from recent episodes of Adventure Time, and also around the middle of the Walking Dead comic. It's around the middle. So, recently Finn, he lost his arm. A similar thing happened in Walking Dead with Rick lost his arm. I did preface it. Robert Kirkman, who is the author of Walking Dead, has said that he regrets getting rid of Rick's arm because it causes a lot of trouble in story making and getting him to do stuff. Do any of the writers or artists here have regrets or ever have trouble with trying to get around that in the recent episodes, or maybe the new comics might feature that?
Oh yeah, so he spoiled two TV shows. And yeah, there are arms that aren't on characters anymore. How does that affect the show?
I don't watch Walking Dead, so I don't know how to comment on that. But we've been building towards Ben losing an arm for several seasons. Talking to each other, being like, when are we going to do it? And are they going to let us do it? And then, I don't know, then we just did it. And I was talking to Tom Kirby, and he was like, what does it mean, man? I was like, what do you mean, what does it mean? And he was like, why did we do that? And I was like, oh, that's cool, man. That's awesome.
I like the idea of from the very first episode, and it was one day. This is in the grand design.
Well, it started because Adam Ludo did a joke, a throwaway joke, in an episode where Finn is meditating, and he imagines himself as like a sort of like berserk kind of anime guy. that drawing was.
Yeah, it's like the, wasn't it like the beard and the arm? Like
yeah. A lot of people drew that and on the internet, and they were obsessed with that image. And I thought it was cool that Finn didn't care about losing his body parts. So I put that in who would win. When he talks to this guy, the train, and the train broke his legs, and he's like, I'm getting new legs. And Finn's like, that's cool. And, you know, so, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know if that answers your question.
Like, Michael, did you have to design the, like, the severed arm as a prop?
No, but that would have been cool.
Nice one. Because, like, on that, like, little, like, that, like, sheep all by itself, just, like, this arm.
Well, plus I look at like what the list is before I read the storyboard, so it would have been a nice weird spoiler for myself to like Finn severed arm.
Alright, purple-ish shirt?
Thank you.
Oh, okay. First of all, did you guys know that Bruce Willis is dead throughout the entirety of Sixth Sense?
What? I'm going to watch that!
Second, what kind of creative license are you guys given with creating and illustrating the comic? Like, what, how much comes from the television show, and like what, and what do you create on your own? And do you ever need to worry about, you know, paths crossing? And I realize that, you know, the line of Wu is a very crazy place, but like, what are you, can you describe your limitations or lack thereof?
Yeah, for me, doing the writing, in theory, there's all these layers of people who can say no. Like, there's my editor. Hi, Shannon. And then there's her boss. I presume you have a boss at some point. Yeah. And then there's Cartoon Network, and there's Penn, and there's all these people who can say, this is crazy, don't do this, but they never do that. Like, go on, dude, go nuts. There have been times, there's one issue 4, there's a flashback to Marceline as a little girl. And I was talking with Penn about that, and we were, it was gonna be a flashback to the Lich's origin, but then there's gonna be a different one in the show coming up next season, and we wanted to have them match up nicely, so we're like, we don't wanna spoil that, so we do something else. And we went back and forth, I think there were like 8 drafts of different things we could do without spoiling something on the show, but still doing a nice moment. Because we want them to fit up together as best they can, so that when you pick up the comic, you don't go, oh, this is wrong. This is not like the show feels. Which means Finn is going to be losing his arm in the comic very soon. Because otherwise it would feel weird and wrong. But there's no people saying no to me. Which is really nice for something that's a licensed work, where presumably people could be like, no, that can't happen because I don't like it. But it's been really great in that sense. Okay, what do you think?
Yeah, this is funny because I can actually talk about this one. So I'm doing the graphic novels, which are kind of these self-contained stories, and they do kind of feel like they're a little bit separate from the Adventure Time world, because you're sort of really focusing in on these side characters, where, you know, in Ryan's series, it's the main characters, Finn and Jake, in their adventures, but mine are these sort of side characters, and they're, in both of the books, they travel to these, like, completely different, like, I just invented, I mean, the first one's in the Nidosphere, but the next one is just like, there's entirely new races of people and
all. You want to spoil it for me?
No! I'm not that guy! But, yeah, so I kind of take these characters that you're really familiar with and take them on, you know, to these entire other areas of Ooh and these different races of people and different kingdoms and things like that. And I had really expected them to just be like, what? No, pull it back. And that, again, never happened. Written the first 2 issues of Bravest Warriors, because my friend Ian Ginty's gonna be drawing it, and yeah, that starts soon. And that, it kind of picks up after they did like 6 issues that sort of take place in between 2 episodes, so we're sort of starting on like a fresh arc, and you know, I've written them and nobody's just been like, that's weird, stop that. So, I don't know, it's good. There's a lot of creative license on the comics.
You're really good.
Thanks, Shannon. You're so brave and smart.
All right, next question. Oh, yeah.
Hi, you guys just finished up like a like super long season, had about a month's break, and have started into the new season. Do you know if this is kind of the show's going to wind down anytime soon? Because I know it's super successful, but I've heard rumors that it could be possibly last season. Do you know if it's going to anything about that?
Oh, I'll quickly repeat the question. Will the show end anytime soon?
I haven't heard any of those rumors, you know, but you don't know how true they are, and I hear stuff, conflicting stuff all the time, and basically there's no answer. I know the show's still doing really well, and it's doing good for the network. I don't know how long I can keep working on the show. I feel like I'm dying.
The kind of like the schedule you guys are on is kind of terrifying to me. Like, I'm kind of glad I just freelance and stuff. It seems like it's kind of, because, well, like, Michael, you're not like in the studio, but it's still like you're doing a lot of work.
Yeah, I mean, I always know when I have a lot of work, it means that everybody else is like four times as much work. Because I'm like the guy who draws like mugs and like.
But it's really hard to draw a good mug.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised. I feel like I couldn't do your job.
I still get revisions on those mugs.
It's just like Adam just like tracing over your mugs like every day.
Kind of.
Hat. My question is, what is it about Adventure Time that resonates with you?
What is it about Adventure Time that resonates with you? Maybe we'll start with Becky.
I just like how there's so many characters and there's just so much you can do with the world, and there's all these like, you know, like side characters and stuff like that that have such good personalities, and I like how the show allows artists to do, like you can tell what artists have worked on an episode. Like I remember seeing an episode of Planet, like, oh, Steve Wolfhard storyboarded that. I could just tell by like how the Jake looks. And most of the shows you watch, you can't tell, like it seems like every episode's made by the exact same person. Like, you don't get to see the artist's personality shine through it. So that's what I like about it.
Cool. Anyone else got thoughts on that?
I like basically the same thing, that the personality of the characters, the depth of their interests and motivations. There's a lot of stuff that in another show you'd think would be very shallow, like, oh, Ice King likes princesses. And that is knowing where it begins and ends with like no heart from Care Bears, who I think about a lot, I guess.
First thing that comes
to
mind.
Yeah. But Ice King obviously has way more going on in his inner life and outer life than just I like princesses. And that gives you a lot of fun stuff to play with when you're using these characters.
Yeah, I like the elasticity of it, just because there are so many characters in the Adventure Time world and so many places, and it sort of is in sci-fi and fantasy, and it plays in so many different genres, and you know, video games, and then crazy medieval lore, and it's all over the place, so you can kind of do whatever you want. So writing the comics, it just feels like you have so much creative freedom, because it's not like you have to stay, you know, Scooby-Doo, like they have to go to a house and you know, find out that the security guard is dressed as a monster. So this is the spoilers panel.
You spoiled like every Scooby-Doo.
So it was like, I mean, they asked me to pitch the first book, and I was just kind of like, well, okay, I just wanted to be really goth and really punk rock, and I wanted to be about Marceline in hell. And they were like, yeah, okay. So that was awesome. But you can do that, and you can have these, like, the crazy episodes where they're in 3D, and you can have, like, the tower, and which is, and all the messed up Lemon Hope stuff, so. It's fun.
Cool, okay, another question? Anything?
I haven't heard of any other show for the Cartoon Network that's as wild and crazy as Adventure Time. The only other one I could think of is Invader Zim, which is awesome also. And I just want to know how much of the you have your extent to like just go anywhere with it.
Just like asking about like the plot and like the plotting. So like Jesse, that'd probably be good one for you.
How far in advance is it thought out? Is that what you're
saying? No, but like you have the ability to do whatever you want in Adventure Time. Like, there isn't another show that can say that, really.
I don't know. I mean, I haven't worked on another show, so.
I don't know. You know, I have no idea. I mean, and also there are constraints. The constraints of the show is that whether or not there's consensus in the writer's room.
Right.
You know, so everyone has to, you come in with an idea, you're like, I want to do this idea about Finn and Jake's brother, you know? And I was trying to pitch that for like three seasons. And like, you know, you guys only do some Jermaine. And we would talk about it and I would give them ideas, but then if the guys in the writer's room and you sit down with them and it's just like not working for whatever reason, because there's all this structure stuff that we do adhere to, not like strictly, but there is an idea of structure. And if it's not working for whatever reason, because of conflicting personalities or interests, just that premise will just get trashed, you know? So there's a lot of that. There's a lot of just like sit in the writer's room in the wall. Like, you know, you think it's just like, whatever, I had a dream. You know? I had a dream last night. It's I ate pizza before I went to sleep. Whatever. And that doesn't just get made into an episode. You know? But, yeah, it's like kind of rigorous.
Like if you have like a I've written on Puppycat and like there was like a very similar experience where it's like half the stuff just like doesn't come out. Like it seems like everything's like super limitless. But like it's all within like the strengths of like the story you want to tell and the characters that we want to explore and everything. So like I think there's kind of an illusion around it where it's just like everything's like wild and crazy. But really it's like half the stuff is like gone. Like half the episodes I pitched will like never ever happen for Puppycat because it's just like it doesn't fit into like what Natasha's trying to do and I guess like what Penn and everyone's trying to do on the show as well. Let's go on to the far side of the room over there.
You guys do something really cool in that versus a lot of things on TV, you guys actually age the characters and time passes. Like there'll be an episode where say a couple months happens or one season Finn's like 12 or the next one is like 13 or 14. And it's just a neat little thing and I'm just wondering, is there a plan with where that's going? Like time passing, like Jake has had kids and had them and month has passed and they're, I mean they age past or whatever, but is that going somewhere? And can you do like a spoiler?
We're kind of talking about like characters aging and how that like factors into the show, is that about right?
Yeah.
Okay, and is there a plan? Is there a grand plan, Jesse, for Finn's, like the age of the characters?
I think Penn gave an answer about this at Comic-Con, something like, well, you can't, I mean, Jeremy is the voice, you can't, he's getting older, and he sounds older, there's nothing you can do about it. Like, we didn't cast a female voice actor who could be that, do that teenage boy voice forever, you know? Like Lisa's Bart.
Oh, yeah.
So that was, in one sense, like smart on The Simpsons, whoever decided that. But then, since we didn't, whoever, Penn, when he cast Finn, didn't decide that, now we have to like make something creative out of it and do something that, I don't know how many other shows have ever done that.
Yeah,
cartoons.
It doesn't seem to like happen. Like, I think Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends, they aged Mac for the same reason, because it was just like a young boy who got older. But I feel like it opens up like a lot of doors, like if you don't have to return to stasis for like a character's age all the time. Because like on The Simpsons, it's like, I like The Simpsons, but I'm done. Like, I checked out The Simpsons like 6 years ago. Like, because there's so much of it, and it just, like, it remains the same, and, like, it kind of, like it forces things to advance along, I guess?
I'm really excited for when the kid who voices Catbug hits puberty. I'm really excited for how that's going
to
go.
It's all one of her biggest worries is, like, cancel. Like, you just come to the booth one day, and like,
hey, guys.
Adventure Time
and all the people that work on it
take over the entire cartoon and comic industry.
It's coming. I don't know, man. I think like a lot of people from like the show, and like again, I don't work on the show, like a lot of people came from comics, like indie comics, like in the first place. Like Jesse and Michael in particular just like made comics. Like Steve Wolfhart, like he was involved in Animation in Canada, but he made comics, like Tom Herpick in comics.
it's like, what, like half the people work on it? Like Matt Forsyth, comics?
Yeah, Natasha. Natasha was doing web comics.
Yeah.
Like, half the creative crew all either came out of animation school or comics.
Yeah.
But maybe that's like sort of, there were, on SpongeBob, there were a couple guys from comics, like Sam Anderson.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
But like, even like Sean Cohen, like going like all the way back, like when he worked on Ren and Stimpy, like Bob Camp discovered him at San Diego Comic Con in like 1990. Yeah. Just like walked past his booth and picked up his mini. And it's like,
yeah, and Jack, I was talking to Jim Wittering, and he worked on a Rubik's Cube.
Oh, yeah.
Dude, I love the Rubik's Cube. Yeah.
It's like Jack Kirby. Yeah, Jack Kirby, Jim Woodring. There's like, who else was on Rubik's? That's such a, it's like this, like, it was a Ruby Spears show in like the, it was like the late 80s. And it's like, it's like the Rubik's Cube, like the toy. And it had like a little like Yoda face on it. And it was magic. But also an alien. Yeah. It wasn't very good.
It was. Yeah, and Jim, I think Jim told me he never wanted to work in animation after working on that show.
Yeah, it's like, people were born in like the comic system, like and in like animation, like for like a really long time. It's just like it's become more prevalent now, I guess, with the internet and stuff. Like it's easier for us to like find each other. Also, it's just like the people who make cartoons now are just fans of comics, like and make comics themselves. It's like Rebecca.
Oh yeah, Rebecca. Yeah.
Yeah. Ian. Yeah. Comics are great. Another question? Oh, right there.
One of my favorite parts of Adventure Time is all the different types of people and races. So I was wondering, what are your favorites and why, and what kind of races would you like to see in the comics or the show?
My favorite, take out the candy I was eating on camera. My favorite, I don't know, but I guess it counts as a race. I like really like BMO and robot and reader characters. Because as someone who finds feelings to be boring, Fimo has emotions, obviously, lots of them, really heartfelt emotions. But yeah, I like characters that are othered a bit, and Fimo being separate from most of everyone else and who would be totally fine with that and confident and not have any concerns around it, I find really adorable and cute. And I would like to be a robot friend. It's true. No one else has favorites?
Well, it's a strange question to ask because it's like, what's your favorite race? Robot was a good answer. The one thing I didn't really like about it is I was writing, I don't want to spoil anything, but in an issue of Bravest Warriors, there's basically, it's not a race joke, but it's someone complaining about being segregated against that they're white, basically. It's a very subtle joke. But I went to write it, and I was like, oh, who am I going to give this character, like, who am I going to give this line to? And, like, Chris wasn't in the scene, and I'm like, oh, crap. No one, it doesn't work. And then it's like, you realize that it actually, you know, it was constructed as this very diverse cast of characters, and, you know, that's really awesome, and I like it a lot. Plum is the most fun to write, and she's a fish person, so. Roundabout answer, fish people.
Robots and fish people.
Robots and fish people.
All right, next question. Oh, right there, that's easy.
Okay, how did you come to work on Adventure Time? And to what extent did you pursue it?
Okay, so let's go down like the whole thing. How'd you end up working on Adventure Time?
I'll try to. 2005, I got a grant. No, shoot. I was making mini comics, and this guy in Brooklyn saw my mini comics, Tom Herpig, who was doing some comics also. We became pen pals. And then we were sending each other whatever new comics we were making at the time. And he was the only other comics guy I knew in the anywhere, because I thought I was just working in a hole, basically. And so then when I got a grant to self-publish my first comic, I thanked Tom Herpig in it. And then I was doing comic conventions like this. I was at SBX, and Penn Ward came to SBX, and he bought my comics. And at that point, Tom had been hired, because he's like a superstar, or whatever, drawer. He'd been hired to design on the show, and I thanked Tom in my comic. Penn liked my comics. He saw that I thanked Tom. So he's like, you know this guy? And then he was like, yeah, he's my friend, blah, blah, blah. And then they gave me a test to see if I could storyboard on the show. And then it was about half a year of negotiations and thinking I had a job, and then thinking I didn't have a job. And then and then Kelly Cruz, the producer, called me and said, can you move to LA in 2 weeks? And, and I moved with like literally one suitcase and lived on people's couches for the next like 2 months. That's how I got a job.
Yeah, that's kind of the way it goes, right? It's just like everyone I know who's like been hired for anything, it's just like, you go back and forth and there's like the silence and you're just like working on whatever you're working on, and it's like, oh, can you be here now? Like move across the country, and everyone, the answer is generally, yeah, sure. Because we don't have anything to do, right? Comics. Kate, how did we all get jobs on the comics?
So I've told this story before, but I still really like it. I threatened to kill a baby. So I got into, because I don't work on the show, I work on comics, but I do a webcomic called Kate or Die, which is mostly through Tumblr, and that's kind of how I built up a following. And it turned out that Shannon Waters, who's our amazing editor, and she was following me. So at one point they released that they were doing this Marceline miniseries, and I reblogged it and was like, I would literally kill a baby to work on this series, because I love Marceline so much. And it was, you know, Meredith Graham was ready to draw it, and it was all these people were working on it that I loved. And like the next day I get an email from Shannon that's like, don't resort to infanticide. will you do a cover? Which I was super excited about. So I did that, and then, you know, that sort of led to doing a couple other things. I did a cover for Fiona and Cake, and I did one for Bravest Warriors, and a couple things here and there, and boom, and nothing longer than like 2 pages. And then one day she's like, can I call you? Which was terrifying. They never asked to call you. He's like, okay, so you've done like 2 pages. You wanna like write a graphic novel? I'm like, yeah.
And then you're like, I bet we're going to do that.
Yeah, the longest thing I've ever written was like 4 pages. All my strips are like one-offs, 1-2 pages. So then basically had a month to learn how to write a graphic novel. But it turned out okay. So yeah, and now I'm on Bravest Warriors.
Cool. Yeah. Michael, how'd you end up on the show?
I guess I was drawing comics. I wasn't trained in animation or trained in anything, I guess. So I wasn't seeking out it. Gig in animation, but like we said earlier, a lot of Adventure Time people or comics people, so I've met a few or corresponded with a few. And Tom Herbig and Phil Ridna told me I should do a design test, and I thought like, oh, this is a nice thing to do, but like I didn't think there was any chance that I would get anything. So I did the test, and then I got the gig, but they were like, can you move to LA? And I said no. For like a bunch, I had a girlfriend at the time who lived here, and can't drive, like all the practical things, like I would probably just immediately like die in LA. But then a few months later, I did some concept art for them, and eventually there's like some shuffling around in the staff, and they're like, well, this guy already did the test, and like we know he can do the thing, and I don't have enough responsibilities that like I need to be there, I guess, or something. They're like, yeah, just sure, you can just do it from like in your underwear in your basement.
Yeah. And that's actually how you do it, like in your underwear in your basement?
Yeah, it's in my contract.
my story is pretty simple, I guess. I was at my computer, and I got an email from Shannon, and she was like, hey, I'm Shannon. I'm doing... I don't even talk like that. I don't know why I make better voice. She said, hello, my name is Shannon. I'm a professional. And I'm going to be editing this back. Yes. And she was like, we need it in a couple weeks, and I was like, no problem. It was kind of a problem. I was like, I'm gonna be professional and say no problem. Do it. So yeah, it was, but that story disguises the fact that I'd been doing comics for 10 years before then, and she wasn't just going through like a Yahoo directory of but do you wanna work on the comic? So again, I guess doing comics is a good way to do things that are also comics or tangential. Comics, yeah. The comics adjacent.
Use the internet.
Internet.
We're
right? Yeah. I was trying to think about it, like, I don't remember. I just remember Mr. Drawing a cover one day, but I don't remember how that happened.
Yeah, one day we spoke up in a daze and we were working on it.
We got an email or we met Shannon in real life. I don't remember what happened first. But we asked to do a cover, but once again, we're also doing our own comics and posting things online. And then I did like a couple of the like fall and winter special covers. And then for Baby Cakes, we just emailed Shannon. We're like, we want to do a comic called Baby Cakes. She's like, okay. We didn't give any plot or anything. She's like, that's fine.
Yeah, there was like a little picture to go with it as well.
Yeah.
It's like kind of like.
Like babies, but like
yeah.
Yeah.
And
your job's really easy, Shannon.
Yeah, okay, so we've got like 10 minutes left, so let's take a couple more questions.
You look really excited about it.
Moving your arm.
Green shirt there.
Oh, what's everyone's favorite episode?
Favorite what?
Episode.
Oh. No.
Oh. I think most recently, the one that where Finn loses his arm.
Mm-hmm.
I think Steph's Tom and Steve, and I remember when they pitched it, I was like, whoa, like, I got sort of upset, like, I was like, I don't know if I can do anything that's good. So I got upset, but really excited, that competitive nature kind of, you know, thing, I guess. But that one, yeah.
Mine is What Was Missing, and everyone knows why. So, yeah, it's, there's a couple different ones, and mine are really typical, but What Was Missing is a great one, where they're trying to sing a song to unlock a wall, and everyone has a lot of feelings, which I'm into. The Simon and Marcy episode was just like, I don't know, I sat back after I watched it, and I was just like, damn, the show! And it's so weird, because I feel like I gotta keep up on all the episodes and watch it every time, but sometimes I see them and I'm like, I'm not this good. And yeah, the one with his arm was just, that was crazy. That felt like a very big moment. So yeah, I have two favorites, sorry.
I don't know if I could pick one favorite, but I like anything like Lemon Grab or Lemon Hope. I feel like that's just an aspect of the world that I always enjoy seeing another storyboard, like, oh, there's more of this, cool.
This is awful. I can't even think of, this is like, what's the prettiest star in the sky? And then I'm like, well, what's my least favorite episode? And I, again, coming up blank, which is pretty good, so.
My least favorite episode is Webbeard Ghost. Just so y'all know.
Why is that your least favorite? Because mine.
It just came out all wrong, I don't know. I work on it, so I'm allowed to say that. Webbeard Ghost sucks. Oh, you like that one? All right, it's okay.
That's like the perfect argument where it's just like, I don't like this episode. It's okay. I guess it's fine. That's how the world should work. Becky,
I like the Fiona and Cake episodes, and also the one with the puppies, the rainbow puppies. Yeah, any of the cute episodes?
I'm a big Steve Wolfhard. Friend fan. I'm a fan of my friend. But I forget the name of the episode, but it was the one where he goes into like the Pillow Kingdom.
Yeah.
That tore me to pieces.
Isn't
like,
that disease, like future Finn? Isn't that in that episode?
He grows, he becomes a future.
No, it's so good. And just like the immediate forgets all of it as soon as he comes out. I was like, oh. You're so mean. I also watched it on a plane, and it was really cool that it was on a plane. Because there's nothing on a plane. There's no joy on a plane.
I also have to mention Bebo and Bubble, because that was one of my favorites.
Cool. We got, let's say one or two more. Yellow shirt.
Okay, so I don't know if anyone will know this, but. So there's a lot of songs on the show, which everyone likes a lot, and it seems like the writers are writing the songs as opposed to like outside songwriters, which I guess is a unique talent. Like, how do people decide, oh, there's going to be a song here, there's going to be like a full song in this episode? The last one was Finn singing, but it wasn't like, he was kind of repeating the same thing over and over. But yeah, how do you decide when you want a song in this episode? Who's gonna write the song? How does that all work?
So how do the songs come about, Jesse?
That was established pretty early when Penn was writing the early songs in that. And I think it's just one of those things where if it feels, because the show is not a musical, right? But if it feels right, like it's gonna enhance an emotion or something, then sometimes you break into song. I don't know. You know.
Yeah.
Some of these do that. Like Tokyo Drifter, it's like super nerdy for me to say that. Tokyo Drifter, it's a good movie, and it has a part where the guy, he's a Yakuza and he breaks into song for no reason. And it's awesome. So sometimes if you're writing a thing, you're like, it feels right if there's a song here, I don't know why. And I know that when Rebecca Sugar was boarding on the show, she was encouraged to write Penn and be like, so you're going to put a song in this one, right? And it's going to be the best one, right? So.
Jesse, have you written a song in any of the boards?
Have I what?
Have you written a song?
Yeah, you. Not ones that people remember. Really.
Yeah, which ones? Which ones?
I did a Marceline singing to her diary, from her diary, in Marceline's closet. And it was like weird. I was trying to write a song that no one would like. So I succeeded, I think. And I wrote Finn's rap. Finn's political rap. The Metasphere one. And Finn's rap battle, rap bear. There's one coming up that my brother wrote in an episode called Greasy. That's better than anything I ever
wrote. The climax of the first arc, I put in a rap battle because I wanted to have music, but you can't really do music in comics that well, but you can do raps. So.
I love writing songs and poems. But in, you know, it's in the comics because I don't work on the show, and if I did the first episode, I would have songs in it for sure. But I got to write them, and like specifically into the Marceline one, where it's a musical one, there's a bunch of times where people are, you know, it's sort of the big climax of it is it takes place in song. And my greatest hope every day is that someone will send me a link that someone on YouTube has actually like made it into a real song. Because all it is lyrics, so you can do whatever. So I keep waiting for that, but. Someday. Someone's gonna do it.
Cool, and we can do exactly one more. One.
I think you should get this guy in a black shirt here.
Yeah, let's go with that guy.
I'm sure.
What is your least favorite Adventure Time character?
I have a character?
Yeah, I actually have one. I talked to Steve Wolfhard about this. He loves tree trunks, and I do not like tree trunks.
What?
I know, I'm the only one.
You do not like tree trunks?
I don't. She's in the first issue of the comic. She gets sucked into the witch's bag. I never show her coming out. She hasn't appeared since. But that was a little, first time I revealed that. It's a little tiny joke about how I don't like tree trunks. I don't know what to do with her besides apples. Like, you give her apples and then you brush her hands off.
She's like, she's sexy.
I respect that, but I don't care.
Mine is like it's complicated because I don't like what Lemon Hope or what Lemon Grab became. Because I love Lemon Grab. I mean, Lemon Grab was when that character was first introduced. There's just something terrifying about it that I completely loved.
He's my favorite still.
Yeah, but yeah, he's great. But when I got to do the Fiona and Cake thing, they were like, you know, if you do a backup, what do you want to do it about? I'm like, oh my god, can I make the lady version of Lemongrass, which I got to do, which was amazing. But then the ones that the show, every time I watch it, and he just gets scarier and like psychologically just terrifying, the stuff that happens with Lemongrass, like eating his brother and talking from the inside. So it's like my heart's breaking a little every time. I'm like, what did you become?
Like Jesse?
I would say I hate Donnie. I'll never do an episode of Donnie in it. Maybe that means I'm gonna try.
Yeah.
To make him better.
Which one's Donnie?
He's like the grass bully. Like he's a ogre.
Oh yeah.
I know Penn didn't like Tiffany for a long time. And then we made one last job, and then he changed his mind about Tiffany.
Michael?
Well, I kind of want to say tree trunks too, but yes. I feel like she makes me really uncomfortable, but then I say, maybe that's good. Like, I should be confronted or something.
Becky, do you have one?
I've been thinking about it. I really can't think of any character that I like just hated or anything. I don't know. I don't really have an answer.
Cool. I hate Finn, Penn Lover. Yeah, we're done actually. Yeah, like literally we're running out of time. But thank you so much for coming, everybody.
I need a transition. I'm going here. Bye.